Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Now that the sides have all their dados and have been ripped to the correct width, it's time to start laying out the holes for the adjustable shelving. To help with the layout, I'm once again using a story stick to mark the location of one of the holes so I know where to set my shelving jig. I have a mark that represents the proper location starting down from the top and another up from the bottom. It's very important the holes line up exact on both sides to ensure the shelves will be parallel with each other and not be all wobbly. Once I make my initial marks, I double check their locations. Then, I strike a line with my square so I can reference it with my shelving jig. I'm using the Veritas Shelf Drilling Jig to accurately lay out the holes for the adjustable shelves. It's tempting to drill a series of holes the entire length of the side, but the fact is I only need 4 or 5 towards the top fixed shelf and the same number towards the middle fixed shelf, and will repeat that on the bottom towards the bottom shelf. This jig is easy to set up and clamps itself to the sides by simply tightening the knurled knobs in the front. Using the line I struck earlier, I line up one of the holes of the jig centered on it and insert the bush guiding, and away I go. Normally I'd recommend using a stop collar on the drill bit to ensure you don't accidentally blow through the sides, but in this situation a piece of tape worked fine for me. Once I have the first set of parallel holes cut, I loosen the jig, then I reposition it just a little bit lower for the next set of holes to be drilled. Once again, position the drill bushing guide in place, repeat the process of drilling the parallel holes, and then once I'm done with that, I'll now repeat this process on the lower half of the side and on all the other sides too. When all the sides have been drilled, it's time to start the assembly and glue up. I begin by laying out the sides on some sawhorses. They're quite long, so I want to get them as properly supported as possible, not to mention level also, so they'll come out square. I lay the sides side by side, trying to line up the dados so I can move things into position quickly once the fixed shelves are set in place. We want to move quickly so the glue doesn't set up before we can get everything in position. Obviously, I've sped up the footage, but it's a matter of brushing the glue on so it's just enough, but not so much it makes a mess we have to clean up later. Once the top is done, it's time for the middle and then the bottom fixed shelves. We'll be cutting it close, but we're now ready to position the fixed shelves themselves. Even though I'm painting this project, I still have a preferred side I want facing up. I probably should have marked it, but I quickly find it and insert the shelf into the dado. With the bottom fixed shelf in position, we'll then move to the middle shelf. The top is no different, but since we have this blind rabbit joint, we already know which face is up and which is down. It's just a matter of snugging it flush with the front edge. Time to put the assembly in overdrive and put the opposite side in position. This is where it gets interesting lining everything up, and hopefully we've applied just enough glue so it doesn't drip all over the place. And then on goes the first of many clamps to snug it all together. Pay close attention when you're applying clamps to a project like this. If you've already taken steps to ensure it's level and square, a clamp that isn't applied right could potentially misalign it. Of course, if it turns out there's a little misalignment anyways, just readjust the clamp to correct it, and you know, we'll talk more about that later. While the first of the shelves is clamped up, I'm starting to cut pieces for the nailing strips we'll use to attach them to the walls, one at the top and one in the middle. I have these 3 to 4 inch wide scraps from when I ripped the sides to width, and they're the perfect size. A couple of cross-cut passes on the table saw, and I have the first of the lengths that I need. Then, it's over to the bench and onto the Craig pocket hole jig. I'm using pocket holes for this procedure because no one will see them once they're in place, and also because it's quick, easy, and they'll hold nice and strong. All you have to do is drill one set of holes at one end, flip the board end for end, and then repeat the process. It couldn't be simpler. Once the shelves are out of the clamp and glued up, I position the first of the nail boards into place just below the middle fixed shelf. I want the fit to be a little snug to help hold it in place. Then I'll grab a clamp to help keep it in position while I drive the first screw. Now, another advantage of the nail boards is that even after careful preparation at assembly to make the shelves nice and square, if there is any reason they ended up slightly not square, these components will actually help to bring them into square quickly and securely. All right, so that was a good place to stop today's episode. Let's go ahead and start talking in the second half about a topic I've slightly alluded to in the assembly phase of the shelves themselves, and that's proper clamping. And actually, more importantly, what we're going to talk about today is some things that we can do while we're clamping. If we discover that something is out of square, we can adjust it to bring it back into square. And this is very, very crucial. Well, obviously, if your project needs to be square, in the situation of these bookshelves, I wanted them as square as possible. If I were, say, building an entertainment center, a dresser, or maybe a small four-sided box, again, I want those nice and square because, well, they're going to help to make sure that the components that fit into them, especially in the situation of, say, a dresser where you want the drawers to fit nice and smooth so that they're going to open and close without any issues, unless, of course, you design it to have anything except square, you want to make sure that these things are going to end up the way that you wanted them to. In the case of a box, you want the lid to fit the right way, and if it's out of square, you may find that the lid is slightly off kilter and it's not gonna close the way you want it to. But anyways, though, without getting too far away from this, what we ended up doing when we were assembling the shelves themselves, of course, we put the sawhorses down. I mentioned that I made them as level as possible, and that's gonna help out when it comes to making sure that everything is square. One more thing I should mention before we get a little bit more into the clamping pressure. This is a reason why doing a dry run before we apply the glue is really, really crucial. Because during that dry run, we don't have to worry about speeding along and getting the clamps in position because the glue is about to set and we still have, you know, three or four more things that we have to put in position. During the dry run, we can get everything where it's supposed to be. We can double check it with our squares to make sure that it's nice and square, or if there's an issue with the joinery, we can fix it then. Or if there's an issue with a component, we can fix it then. The time not to do it is once you've applied the glue and you're running through with the clamps themselves. But anyways, though, a really quick fix when it comes to proper clamping pressure is, well, number one, using the right clamps. There are some really neat tools on the market, some accessories for our clamps that can really help you to assure that when you're putting the project together, it'll always be square. One tool in particular that always comes to mind for me, I made some of these in the shop with some scrap plywood I had. Those ones have actually worn out. Maybe we should come back and make some more of them. But they're these really neat L brackets. In fact, over at Highland Woodworking, I believe they're called 3D squares. And I also believe that Lee Valley carries these, and I'm pretty sure Rockler and Woodcraft. In fact, I think Rockler might have their very own ones. The ones at Highland Woodworking, I believe it's an aluminum body. The ones at Rockler tend to be more of a high density plastic. But regardless of which ones you have, these are really great because they're 90 degrees. So you would end up using two clamps to help put these in position. And the idea is when you have a component that needs to be nice and square, you would have preferably probably about four, maybe six of these, depending on you know, what you're assembling. In the case of our shelving unit here, six would have been great because we'd have two for the top shelf, two for the middle, and then two for the bottom. But we could easily have gotten away with four. Sorry, little tangent there.
But the process of using these is you would use one clamp that would typically hold the square to, say, the side, and then you're going to use another clamp, and you would push that square up into position so that it is right in that corner, and then you'd have another clamp up in what would be maybe the other side or the top. So you have these two clamps, and it forces the piece to be nice and square. And this is really great because, again, we don't have to worry about it. We know for a fact that that's square, that we can just concentrate on getting our clamping pressure onto those joints and make sure that they hold them in position. So that's a really neat accessory. Lee Valley also makes another accessory, which really is, again, feeding on that idea of this L-shaped type clamp. It's more or less a clamp that you'd put right into the corner, and then you pinch it, and it holds it together. I know Highland Woodworking also has one, and again, Woodcraft and Rockler probably have them also. Those are really neat. They're obviously much more expensive. The cool thing about these ones is that built-in kind of a ratcheting system that they have holds it together, so you don't have to worry about having more clamps on hand, say like some of these big ones here, or maybe some quick sliding clamps or something. You can use those elsewhere, like making sure that those sides are coming together really, really tight, where you let the accessory ones worry about whether they're square. And like I said, also, you can make them in the shop. I'll make sure to try to have links to the one that I had originally built way early, I think in year one or year two. We did like a jig of the week or something like that. We'll see if we can find it. No promises, though. So we have those. But let's say that you just, in the situation I am right now, I just have just my regular old clamps. There's a really easy way that we can make sure, if we find while assembling that it's slightly off, just using our jigs, it's a matter of just making a slight adjustment into or out of whatever direction is not square. So let's come over here to, well, we're going to do it on the table saw right now because I have this great bird's eye maple that came in a project pack that I ended up getting from folks over at Bell Forest, which we're going to see this project coming up hopefully before the end of the summer. Really excited about this. It's kind of a fun, you know, weekend project, definitely. But anyways, we'll come over here and we're just going to make a pseudo little box, and I'll show you what I'm talking about with using these clamps to adjust it so that we can take it from out of square and back into square. All right, so we have this amazing bird's eye maple, and we're going to go ahead and let's assemble our bird's eye maple box that we're building for somebody. So we're just going to put this together, and we're going to do this dry run first just to make sure that all the joinery comes together where we want it. And we'll just apply, let's apply our clamps where we need them. And so this one's good here, and we'll go ahead and apply this one. And here, we'll just get this in position, because remember, we're going to be testing the joinery itself. So let's go ahead and look, and all right, so there, now it's nice and square. We'll test in a second location. Oh yeah, that looks nice and square. So we're good this way. Now, let's go ahead and take the clamps off, and use our imagination. Oh, we apply a little glue, bring everything back together. We knew that the joinery worked exactly the way we wanted it. Everything's going together nice. So we take our clamps, and once again, we will put them on. We'll get them tightened in position, just like we did with our dry run. And therefore, we know that, well, since it worked in the dry run, it has to work in the assembly itself, right? All right, well, let's find out. So we go ahead and we're putting our square on, and we're starting to discover that, no, that's not the situation at all. In fact, it went from being square to out of square. In fact, what we've discovered is that the direction that this has gone out of square, and this is where panic would kick in, because remember, we've got this glued up, so we want to make sure that everything's ready to go before that the glue dries. We've discovered that it has shifted slightly so that this corner is out of square. If it was square, it'd be coming in this direction, but in fact, it's actually shifted this way, and definitely here that way also. So what we want to do is we actually want to force these corners to kind of turn almost, to kind of come in this direction so that we could get them the way we want it. Now, you're very tempted to take all your clamps off and start all over again, but what I might suggest is let's just do something as simple as we'll leave this clamp in position, and like we said, we want to turn it this way. We want to kind of bring it around this way. So what we'll do is let's take this one clamp and let's reposition it by leaving this clamp head pretty much where it is, but let's pull this clamp head towards this corner. And we'll go ahead and do that, and now we got that in position now. We can see that, well, this clamp head is much further forward, and it really doesn't even have to be much further, just a little bit. And let's see if that forces it. Okay, it's almost there. In fact, we need to push it just a little bit more. So we might have better luck if we switch it around for the more adjustable one here. Oops, oh no, that glue fell apart. So let's go ahead and get it back into position. And you can see that I've really got this pushed in here to that corner. So let's get the clamp to grab a hold. And our example is starting to fall apart on us a little bit, but there we go. Now we got it so that there's much more pressure coming this way, and as a result, we actually have overcompensated. Now we have it going back out that way, so we know we still got a couple more minutes before that glue is going to be fully cured, or way more than it. Then we could make the adjustment. So we pull this back just a little bit. And all right, we're almost there. Yeah, almost there. So now we need to just ease off just a little bit more. Not quite as much as it was. All right, there we go. Now we've got it nice and square, right where we want it. And it was just a matter of pushing one of the heads into the position along that the desired direction that we want to kind of turn it. If this box had been so that we wanted to turn it more towards, say, the left, like it's coming towards me, we would have positioned it so that this head was deeper into that one side that we want to kind of turn it. But in this situation, we went clockwise, so we were able to come that way. Another thing that we can do, if in the situation that since this box is this size, I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to reposition this clamp to where we had it originally so that, again, it's slightly out of square. And what we'll do is just check to make sure that we're back to out of square again. In this situation, we're going to grab a clamp and we're going to go across these two corners, and that will help to twist it. So let me grab another clamp and we'll do that. Okay, so now we have a very much larger clamp. In fact, this one is big enough that it is going to stretch right across that diagonal. And this is going to be a little bit trickier in this situation because, well, this particular clamp, we've got to make sure that we get it just the right way so that it doesn't slide off or damage our corners. So we might want to put some scraps in position to keep that from happening. But again, we want to turn it so that this corner is going to move to its right. It's so clockwise. So what we're going to do is I am going to put this in position across that width. And I have the head of this clamp is, or this portion of the clamp is pretty much right on that corner. This other one, which is adjustable, and we'll get a picture here, it is kind of pushing on that side that we want it to go. So it's pushing clockwise. So it's pushing towards the left. And I'm just going to, you don't need a lot of pressure here. You just a couple of turns, just enough to get the clamp to hold. And we're going to test it. And just that little bit that we did pulled it nice and square. We have barely any pressure. Like if I was to grab this clamp and lift it up, it would come right off of it. But it's enough that it's going to hold this so that as the glue dries, it's nice and square. So that's a really, really, really nice thing that we can do. If this was much bigger, if this was a much larger piece, we would definitely have to come up with another way to do this. But in most situations, this little method here works great. In fact, one thing we could do is if we had very long pipe clamps, we could even potentially string a few of them together to try and pull it. But I think this gives a good example of how we can compensate for it so that we can fix the mistake while it's gluing up, and in the end, it will actually stay the way you want it to be. So hopefully that little demonstration kind of helps you come up with a plan just in case well, your project turns out to be not square once you do start applying the clamps after glue up. It's probably the worst time in the world that it can happen, and it's the time we're most likely to panic and not be able to think clearly about how to fix it without tearing the whole entire thing apart and just wishing that we had never even started. One other accessory I forgot to mention is a web clamp, much like this. That would work great with a project the size of this little box that we were kind of demonstrating with here. But on a much larger project, again, it would be very limited by the length of that webbing. And to be quite honest with you, that makes these type of clamps, I enjoy having them. There's times that I do use them. But to be quite honest with you, oftentimes I find that they're more of a pain to set up and get going than they're really worth. So what I might do is use my regular clamps to get things in position, come back, put that on there, and then this could also be an aid to take care of any out of square situation. One more thing to think about. Typically when we're putting in a back on a project, if the project ends up being slightly out of square while we're assembling it, oftentimes, depending on how the project is assembled, more than likely that back will help to put things into square. Now, this will also be a little nerve-wracking because as you're putting the back into position, especially with a plywood back, what ends up happening is you hear a little pop, 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 and if you're not careful, you could potentially break a little bit of the joinery as you're putting that back into position because you might roughhouse it just a little bit more. You might add a little bit more pressure to get it in, but adding a plywood back to something oftentimes is all it needs to bring it into square. I do it quite a bit with drawers. As I'm assembling the drawer boxes themselves, they seem to be a little out of square, but as soon as I drop that plywood position or the plywood piece into place for the bottom, or even if I'm using some solid wood, which I really haven't used, so I don't know why I said that, but if I were, oftentimes as long as that bottom or the back of, say, a case was nice and square, the plywood or whatever you're using, that will help to put it into position. So, you know, maybe something like this where we're running around trying to get it into place, you might not have to be as concerned about it because that back or the bottom is going to take care of it. Anyways, though, if you have a different way of doing this, a great suggestion, we'd love to hear it. Leave a comment in the comments for today's show, something that all of us can share and use in our next project. We really appreciate it. Don't forget to stop by the website where you can leave that comment. That's mattsbasementworkshop.com. Welcome to see all of you over there. I hope to hear from you. And, of course, you can also drop me a line at our email, which is mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Again, hoping to hear from all of you. And if, like I said, if there's something we didn't discuss as an option for what we can do, please let us know. So anyways, I'll be talking to all of you later. I've got to clean up this shop. I want to make sure I can get started on this bird's eye maple project that I have here. But anyways, I'll talk to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
To find the show notes and links mentioned in today's episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. There you'll find information on how to subscribe to the show, enter our monthly swag drawings, and more. And while you're there, please consider helping to support the show by visiting our various advertisers and sponsors. By clicking on the links and making purchases, you not only have a chance to buy great tools and services for yourself, but you also have a chance to help support the show.